helping leaders motivate their people to a higher level of performance through strong human relations, team building, and goal achieving. This is the 7-Minute Leadership Podcast with your host, Paul Falavolito.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to the 7-Minute Leadership Podcast. This is episode 114, and do I have a treat for you guys. I talked to this guy several years ago on the Emergency Management Podcast that I do, and it is absolutely my joy to bring him to the 7-Minute Leadership Podcast. As the former Deputy Commissioner at the New York City Office of Emergency Management and Chief Disaster Officer for the American Red Cross in Greater New York, Kelly McKinney has had a leadership role in every major disaster in New York City for more than 20 years, from the 9/11 attacks to Superstorm Sandy to COVID-19. Currently, he is Assistant Vice President of Emergency Management and Enterprise Resilience at NYU Langone Health in New York City. He teaches crisis management at NYU and was recently appointed to FEMA's National Advisory Council. And finally, he is the author of Moment of Truth, The Nature of Catastrophes and How to Prepare for Them. It is my absolute pleasure to introduce you all to Mr. Kelly McKinney. Welcome to the show.
Thank you, Paul. I'm so thrilled to be here and happy to be talking to you again.
Yeah, I'm glad to hear your voice. I know it's been a couple years, and I'm sure we have a lot to catch up on, but let me just jump into why I wanted to talk with you today. So 697 days ago, I did a podcast. It was called Leading During Crisis. And here we are now almost 700 days away from this pandemic thing. And I figured maybe we need to do part two, because part one was kind of a how-to. I wanted to share some tips with everybody to help them get ready and give them some guidance. And now I think that, you know, a little over 2 years into this thing, we might be able to unpack some of the lessons learned from what we've both experienced and been through as leaders in our current profession. So I guess my first question is, what do you want to tell me about your leadership experience the past 2 years?
You know, as you said in the bio, Paul, I've been in the middle of every big disaster in New York City for 20 years. I got into this business on 9/11. You know, I was standing on the street at Broadway and Chambers Street, looking up at Tower One. I just walked out of the subway when Tower One had been struck. And, you know, I'm standing there on the street as everybody else was, just straight up stock still, you know, staring up with my mouth hanging open. And, you know, the world changed in that moment. It changed for me. It changed for everybody there. It changed for so many people in New York. And that the lessons I learned on that day and in the weeks that followed, you know, have stuck with me. But the issue really is that crises have, you know, for the thousands of years of human history, have affected that subset of people. You know, it affects the people that are in the midst of the crisis. But this incident, this catastrophe, this pandemic encompassed everyone. You're hard pressed to find anyone that hasn't been profoundly affected by the coronavirus pandemic. And that really is the difference. You know, the lessons that I learned, everybody now has at least been exposed to those truths, whether or not they, you know, they're able to use them in a productive way and improve their individual and sort of collective resilience. That's a different question. But I think that's the challenge that we have before us. How do we make this crisis, how do we turn it around and make us stronger as a society? And I right now I see it doing just the opposite. I see it sort of helping to unravel, you know, those societal bonds that have kept us together. You know, the politics that have affected the crisis, the messaging that from those people that we all sort of looked up to and trusted, you know, has all of those things have eroded public confidence and, you know, sort of our feeling of well-being, and we have to get that back.
Yeah. And I'll tell you, I'll be very honest with you. One of my biggest lessons learned going into this thing, you know, making all the plans and all the strategies and all the mitigation and all the guidance and all the guidance that changed every day during those first few months, if you remember that, the one thing that was not on my radar was, what if you don't get buy-in from the public to follow the guidance, right? And so when that hit and when that started happening and there was all that pushback, that really shook me for a couple days trying to figure out, like, oh, crap, now what?
Yeah, and that's exactly it. I mean, Paul, you've put your finger on the root of the problem. And, you know, and I'm going to go to FEMA's Executive Academy next month, and I'm going to talk about this. And one of the things that I'm going to talk about is the politics around it. And I tell people, you know, I'm as middle of the road as it's possible for a human being to be. I'm 50.0% on either side of an issue. And the way that you know that is when all of your conservative friends think you're liberal and all your liberal friends think you're conservative. But the issue is, for me, it, you know, and you know, going back to those lessons I learned, it starts at the top, right? And so in this crisis, it starts with the president. It starts and ends with the president in a large national level, 9/11 class, you know, Katrina class, COVID-19 class crisis. The president owns it. And the problem with the president that we had in place in the beginning of this crisis was that they did everything against the playbook that we all knew to work, and we all knew the steps, and everything that came out of that White House was counter to that. And I think that's what put us, you know, on our back feet. That's what really threw us for a loop, because there was never an acknowledgement of the crisis itself. There was never a rallying of the country and a bringing the country together to steal them and to you know, tap into that collective strength that we have as a country, because we have, right, you know, an enormous,
yeah.
And you know, we have an endless depth of strength. And you know, you think about what this nation has done in past crises. I was looking I was watching this show about World War II and how, you know, Hitler miscalculated and Tojo miscalculated. They thought that we were weak. They thought that we were, you know, that we would not come together. And then when they attacked us and when we declared war on Germany, you know, the men all went to war, and the rest of the society started to build ships, you know, and build planes. I mean, there was nothing that could not be done if you could engage the passion and engage the mind and the soul of the country in a shared mission. That's what didn't happen. And that's leadership. Leadership has to engage your mind and your soul and your passion around a mission. That's the missing piece.
Preach it, brother. Preach it.
Yeah, but that's really that's the issue, you know. And it for me, what happened in the last 2 years has been so much worse than it ever needed to be, and the politics still is horrendous. You know, I saw a thing I saw an article in Wall Street Journal 2 days ago. This is what it said. It said, you know, we just did this poll of the American public, and they all agree on one thing only, and that is that we no longer agree on anything. You know, yeah, that's the one area of agreement that, wow, we have, is that we are polarized and we no longer agree on anything. And that, you know, that's a problem.
Yeah, that's a big problem. So my next question, and this one might be a little hard for you, like, I need you to take your emergency management hat off and take your government hat off. So if I say to you, how has the last 2 years people in private sector business that have been affected, how do you think this has made them a better leader?
Yeah, that's a really good question. And the question is whether everyone has been made a better leader or just some have been made better leaders. And I think, you know, because I don't believe that leadership is innate. I don't believe that you're born with it. Some people are, you know, but I believe that it's something that can be developed, something that can be taught and learned. And I think that, you know, there's this myth of the crisis leader and that, you know, they emerge and they, you know, lead, you know, the people and their organizations to victory or whatever. And I think it's a myth. You know, there are crisis leaders out there, but it needs to be developed. And that's my business. You know, emergency management is the development of crisis leaders, because every emergency manager must be a leader in the midst of crisis. That's what we get paid for. And when people get cast into that crisis world, they're immediately overcome by confusion and fear and the chaos that's in their mind. And they're looking around for someone to tell them what's happening, you know, and where we're going, where we're headed. And emergency managers aren't the leaders. We're not the local elected leaders, but we facilitate and enable that. We put the boss up front and we help to put the message into the boss's mouth so she can say these things that start to get everybody moving in the right same direction and connected together.
Yeah. I think of, you know, what this has done for a lot of, you know, private sector, you know, pick an industry, it doesn't matter. You say, you know, the restaurant industry and these people that, you know, were not on the front lines of COVID like we were in the healthcare industry or in the emergency management world, you know, actually seeing patients, touching patients, treating patients, transporting patients, right? But, you know, then you have the staffing crisis that you throw on top of a global pandemic, and these people that, you know, I would think that if you were the only one that showed up for work that day, right, and your official job title is not shift manager, shift leader, whatever, now you're kind of being thrown into your own frontline battle, right?
Yeah.
You've got to learn this quick. So I think that everybody in the last 2 years, you know, pick a business, you know, like I said, has had their own frontline stories that they're going to tell to their kids and their grandkids in the coming decades about, you know, how COVID impacted them and, you know, how it shaped them as leaders, even though maybe they woke up that morning and they weren't a leader. And by lunchtime, because they were the only one that went to work, now they're kind of leading and doing something.
No, I think that's so true, Paul. I really do. And, you know, so I live in Manhattan. I live on the Upper West Side, and one of the things I'll never forget about March of 2020 was the way that the city shut down and became a ghost town, essentially. You know, the cars were just off the streets. You could walk down the middle of First Avenue and not worry about, you know, getting smashed by a bus, for instance. But so everything shut down, and you know, you talk about those leaders, and it was interesting. There's a restaurant. It's called Café du Soleil. It's a French restaurant, and their owners are French as French can be. They will greet you in French in the restaurant, and they talk to you in French even, you know, 20 years later. They insist upon it. But they are such an important part of the neighborhood. And in the midst of those early dark days when everything was shut down, they stayed open. Their lights were on. They had this window where they would, in those early days, one of the good things was they said, well, you can now serve, you know, cocktails and beers out of to go. And so they opened a window and they stood back there and they served drinks, and the lines were down the block because it was the only thing open, and people went and got a drink and they stood on the street and they stood in the park, and it kept us together. And people, you know, they you know, they'll never forget that. And that place today is, you know, so much more a part of the neighborhood. And there's many other restaurants in my neighborhood that you can say similar things about. They persevered in spite of the hardship, and there was no end in sight. They didn't know if they were going to lose their business. They didn't know if they were going to go broke. They didn't know if they were going to be destitute, but they but they kept going to work and staying open because that's what they did and the people needed it.
Yeah, that's great stuff. So Kelly, as I cue up the closing music here, where can people find your book?
Thanks, Paul. They can find it at wherever good books are sold, Amazon.com and Scribner's, and would love it. It's also available on Audible as an audiobook, so would love to hear anybody's thoughts about it.
I appreciate that, and I will also post links for the book for your Twitter. If you want to follow Kelly on Twitter, that's how we discovered each other many years ago. And I'm happy for the bond and the friendship that's developed over the years with you. But I am going to ask you one more question as we close the show. As you said in the Wall Street Journal article, the one thing that we agree on is we don't agree on anything anymore. Where do we even start to fix that problem?
I think it's with those individual bonds, brother, like you and I have, and people just have to start to build them back. And once we get out of our houses and get those masks off, I think, you know, it's slowly going to come back. And we have to have faith, you know, just keep the faith, and it's all going to get better.
Yep. Well, Kelly, thank you so much for taking the time to be on the show. And that's going to do it for episode 114 of the 7-Minute Leadership Podcast.